So it's been a little over a week since AMD showed off their upcoming processors and graphics cards. Honestly, there is just a lot to talk about. In fact, I've actually covered all of the Navi GPU stuff in a separate video, so if you're interested in that, link will be right over here. But this video is a little bit different from our normal explain series. You see, we wanted to put a little bit more time into reading all of the information that AMD has bestowed upon us with regards to Zen 2 and the upcoming Ryzen 3000 series processors. But the further we got into the information, the same question came up over and over again. How does this all compare to what Intel has to offer right now, and are Intel desktop platforms really in a bunch of trouble? So let's just cut through the hype and get into this from a more balanced perspective while I explain some of the finer points of AMD's approach to third generation Ryzen. Oh, and yeah, this video is gonna be a little bit of a longer one, so definitely make sure to check the comments where timestamps will be pinned. But first, a quick message from our sponsor. The MasterFan series from Cooler Master has now received a fresh new look with a square frame design to generate high pressure airflow and silent operation. The fans feature this beautiful addressable RGB illumination, and you can pick it up in 120, 240, and 360mm variants. Learn more in the description down below. Alright, so let's start with the obvious thing about this whole Intel versus AMD CPU wars. Team Blue was caught with their pants down when AMD announced Zen. Now, what could even be worrying for Team Blue is that Zen 2 seems to be performing even better than anyone else expected, including AMD. They initially thought, you know, of about 7-10% uplift in instructions per clock, or IPC, but it's right now hovering around 15%. But there's more too. Usually companies have some issues moving to a new manufacturing process, like Intel sticking to their 14 nanometer for about half a decade now, since 10 nanometer just wasn't ready. But with the new 7 nanometer technology, AMD has been able to drastically increase density while also cutting power and, of course, increasing performance per watt. Also, do keep in mind that switching processes usually leads to decreased core frequencies between one generation to the next, but somehow AMD was able to avoid all of this, and so their new 7 nanometer based CPUs will have equal or higher frequencies than the ones they replace. Now, if Intel was hoping for lower frequencies to offset AMD's architectural improvements, well, they were clearly wrong. But I also want to focus a bit on that density point from before, because it's going to be really important in the battle against Intel, and it's key point to understanding how AMD can do what they're doing. You might have noticed that Lisa Su showed off a Ryzen CPU that looked something like this, with two smaller dies alongside one larger one. Those small cores are what AMD calls chiplets, and they happen to be the cornerstone of Ryzen's future. Remember I said that density matters? Well, each of those little 74 square millimeter chips houses processing cores, cache, and more. Meanwhile, the larger die you see here is the input-output section that houses things like the Infinity Fabric, memory controllers, and device communications. Diving a bit deeper, those core complex designs chiplets, or CCDs, are super small, but the 7 nanometer manufacturing process allows them to house two quad-core, 8-threaded Ryzen cores and 32 megabytes of L3 cache. Now, when you add two of these CCDs together and you have yourself a CPU with 16 cores and 32 threads, while other designs can be created by simply disabling cores. For example, a 12-core part can be created by including two core complex designs, but disabling one quad-core section. Meanwhile, an 8-core 16-thread CPU can be done by including just a single one of these chiplets alongside this CIOD. But the really cool thing here is that in theory, these 8 cores can keep being added or removed to create all kinds of different products. Now for Intel, this could cause a massive challenge since AMD can now use this modular approach to pack as many 7 nanometer cores onto the CPU, and this will allow them to launch relatively affordable and efficient CPUs with higher thread counts that could potentially overcome some of Intel's most expensive HEDT processors. A perfect example of that would be the upcoming Ryzen 9 3950X, a 16-core, 32-threaded monster that will go for around $750 US. I can't imagine the look of horror on Intel's faces when the price was announced, since their closest competitor would be the i9-9960X. And yes, it goes for a ridiculous $1,700 US. Now, the new chiplet approach does bring up something a bit concerning, and that is heat. You see, while the Ryzen 3000 series processors seem to be really efficient, concentrating heat on multiple cores in a relatively, you know, small package could cause heat buildup. We saw this with Intel when they moved over to stacked 14 nanometer transistors with Broadwell, and AMD could face something similar. Now, supposedly AMD's internal testing proves their chips do run cooler than Intel's, and results like these thermal images seem to prove that, but we will have to test that out ourselves, especially when overclocking. Other than the 3950X I already talked about, AMD's lineup will have a bunch of other processors, starting with the Ryzen 9 3900X, which is their first 12-core, 24-thread CPU available for the AIM4 platform. At $500, it's the most expensive non-Threadripper CPU yet, but if you want something less expensive, there's the $400 Ryzen 7 3800X and the $330 3700X. The last two processors will follow in the footsteps of the 2700X by offering 8 cores and 16 threads, along with higher boost frequencies. All of these have TDPs of just 105 watts, which is really impressive, except the 3700X, which is 65 watts. If rumors are to be believed, that'll allow it to overclock quite high too. One thing that should jump out right away is the fact that the Ryzen 7 3700X costs exactly the same amount as the 2700X when it first launched, so AMD isn't charging a premium for their new architecture. Part of that could be due to how similar the specs are between the 2700X and the 3700X, but I really hope Intel is paying attention here. While the more expensive third-gen Ryzen processors will probably get a lot of attention, we're actually more excited about the 12-thread Ryzen 5 3600X and 3600. Ryzen 5s are usually AMD's performance per dollar leaders, and these newer ones don't look any different. Remember, they're competing price-wise against Intel's 6-core, 6-thread i5-9600K and the 9400, which should be an interesting battle, especially when it comes to budget gaming builds. Here you can pretty clearly see what Intel's likely scrambling right now to get influencers on board and content for their processors out the door. When viewing the battle from this perspective, there's a lot of reason to believe that AMD will be a dominating player at every price point. But there's some areas where AMD may still be a bit weak, and Intel can capitalize on that. More on that in just a bit. Something else that I just wanted to highlight are the two new APUs in this lineup, the 3400G and the 3200G. These are basically updated Raven Ridge APUs, which still use the 14-nanometer manufacturing process and simply bump the clock speeds versus last gen. 7-nanometer APUs aren't due out this year, so these are simply placeholders. Alright, so I mentioned that in some areas AMD might need improvement. You see, if you remember with second generation Ryzen processors, they tended to lag pretty far behind Coffee Lake in single or lightly threaded workloads, and because of that, gaming suffered as well. Now, AMD thinks that they've addressed that with Zen 2. When you combine their design enhancements as well as improved clock speed consistency, there's supposed to be a 21% increase in single-thread performance. In a perfect world like Cinebench, that is. But what about gaming? Well, AMD has also doubled Ryzen 3's level 3 cache sizes and calls it game cache. More cache means more information can be stored locally on the processor's high-speed memory rather than being dumped onto the slower system memory. When you combine that with the fact that Zen 2 can hit 3600 MHz as an overclocked memory speed, there are some big potential frame rate boosts. But does that mean Intel should be worried? Yes and no. On one hand, AMD showed that the Ryzen 9 3900X pretty much matching the 9900K, but remember, the Ryzen CPU costs a few bucks more than the 9900K. It's good to see them being at an even playing field here, and the games seem cherry-picked as well to show the best in Ryzen. What's a bit more concerning is the 3800X versus 9700K benchmarks, because they do show Intel leading in a few more cases. But by how much? Well, there's no way of telling. Just remember that all of these benchmarks are 1080p, and if the resolution was increased, the gap would reduce by quite a bit due to the GPU being a bottleneck. Now, gaming benchmarks was one of Intel's last safe havens against Ryzen, but it looks like AMD is narrowing the gap even further with these new third generation processors. Now, when you look at it overall, there doesn't seem to be a clear-cut winner in the whole 3000 series lineup, at least against Coffee Lake. I mean, sure, they do look better, but a convincing win doesn't look possible yet. Where Intel will lose and lose big time is in multi-threaded performance benchmarks. AMD can simply offer more cores for less money, but there's one thing that we noticed here. There's no way AMD enabled Intel's QuickSync support for that Adobe Premiere test, since with it on, the 9900K would have dominated. Everywhere else, though, the win seems pretty convincing. While virtual threads don't scale nearly as well as physical ones, In this test, we can see that AMD absolutely needs their core count advantage over Intel to win. Even though the V3800X has double the thread count as Intel's 9700K, it can only edge it out by a maximum of 37%. While that's a huge win given the price of each CPU, there are obviously some strong points in Intel's current architecture. Can they actually build on that? We're just gonna have to wait and see. Now, another key selling feature of AMD's next generation platform is the X570 chipset. In fact, if you're interested in learning more about that and the new X570 motherboards, yes, motherboards, super exciting, right? You can actually check out our in-depth coverage of MSI's offerings right over here. But as we kept digging through the information that AMD did provide us, some things did come up that were quite concerning with regards to pricing. One of the most talked about features of X570 is the PCIe 4.0 interface. Super exciting, right? Now, while graphics cards aren't anywhere close to needing the bandwidth it provides, storage devices can sure benefit. Gigabyte, Corsair, and other manufacturers have announced NVMe SSDs that can operate at 5 GB/s, which is absolutely insane. PCIe 4.0 also offers a lot more flexibility for devices that need additional bandwidth, so X570 boards will have a lot more high-end connectivity than either Z390 or X470. The problem we see is cost, since the price of these motherboards is trending upwards. You see, PCIe Gen 4 trace routing requires upgraded PCBs for signaling strength, and many of these standard motherboards actually use workstation technologies, so that obviously drives the cost up. Another thing that's boosting prices is the sheer number of features many of these boards have. That's a vote of confidence from the motherboard makers to AMD, since they now feel Ryzen is the premium product everyone hoped it would become. But finding a lower priced X570 may be a challenge. But to me, what's really concerning is AMD's more affordable B500 series and A500 series that are nowhere to be found. During the last two Ryzen launches, both chipsets were detailed right at the start, but this time they haven't been mentioned at all. Now, luckily, AMD has almost complete backwards compatibility for Ryzen 3000 series processors, but there are some limitations. If you want a more budget-friendly system around third-gen Ryzen CPUs, maybe look for a B450 motherboard or maybe even an X470 if they go on sale. Honestly, I really think the lack of lower-priced 500 series motherboards will end up hurting the Ryzen 5 3600X and 3600 more than anyone else could.
The new Hydro X series from Corsair is a full water cooling ecosystem with transparent blocks for RGB goodness and built-in flow indicators, with soft and hard tubing available and a full array of fittings so you can design the perfect loop for you. Hydro X by Corsair. Everything's linked below.
All right, guys, so I think it's time to bring up that question one more time. Is Intel in a spot of trouble in the desktop market? The answer to that is yes, they probably are. You see, AMD has new CPUs, shiny new CPUs, power-efficient CPUs, loaded with cores, and they also perform very competitively against Intel, and they don't cost a lot of money. But Intel's biggest issue is that they don't have a direct answer to AMD's third-generation Ryzen processors. You see, the Sunny Core architecture isn't ready for desktop yet, and even then, on notebooks, it's only expected to come later in October. But then again, Intel did vaguely announce that they're going to come out with new Core X processors, which I know for a fact are going to be super expensive. Then again, if you think about it, the Ryzen 9 3950X is a direct answer from AMD to that. And remember, it takes years to build changes into a product roadmap. And honestly, Intel doesn't have years or even months. Zen 2 and 7 nanometers are here now, and Zen 3 with refined 7 nanometer process is coming in 2020. So let's quickly talk about what Intel can do right now. Lowering their damn high prices would be a great start, but sadly, they've been completely unwilling to do that in the past. First, they've got to stop burying their faces in sand and making believe Ryzen doesn't exist. AMD and Nvidia battled it out for years with continual price cuts until their next generation cards are ready, and it would work here too. Intel isn't out of the game by a long shot, but I think they've stayed complacent for too long. If the Ryzen 3000 series lives up to expectations, their entire Z390 platform looks like overpriced last-gen tech. Now, of course, AMD needs to actually deliver on their promises and deliver products to buy on July the 7th, But judging from what we've seen so far, I think Intel has a much bigger hill to climb. So that's it for it now, guys, and I would love to know your thoughts about this whole topic. Would you still stick to your current system, or would you consider switching to third gen Ryzen? I mean, does a new platform look appealing to you? In fact, if you have any questions or concerns with these new CPUs, definitely let us know in the comments down below, and we'll definitely make sure to check them out during launch day, which is July the 7th. It's certainly an interesting, exciting month for us here at Hardware Canucks. But yeah, definitely stay tuned. I'm Ibo with Hardware Canucks. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to check out some relevant content over here. And I'll see you guys. It's been a long one. In the next one.